Welcome to Kids Church today. I'm Pastor Scott, and we are working on upgrading some things in here, trying to make our broadcasts better in higher definition, and we're working on that solution right now. I have a great helper who's come in to our church to help us. His name's Chris, and he is fantastic. He knows what he's doing, and he's helping us out, so I really appreciate him. You know, the Lord always sends us the right people when we need to do things. Every soul matters to God. You know, he doesn't care what color your skin is. He cares what he sees right here in your heart. He cares what he sees in your heart, and that's all he's looking at. He knows everything about you. He knows how many hairs are on top of your head. He knows all those things. And you know what? He loves you. He loves you. And he's not looking at what people have done in the past to love them. He loves them no matter who they are and where they're at in their life. He wants them to have a relationship with him and draw closer to him. Let's start with some announcements today. Our 2020 goal, we're at about 24% of it right now. And our goal for the year is $600. So we're going to keep working towards savings up for that. You know, next week is going to be Kids Church Live for those that are ready to come back. And we have the chairs socially distanced here. We've got some clean hand procedures we're going to follow. And make sure that we're safe in here. Our rule, and you know what that is, treat others the way you want to be treated. Show me your Bible. I hope you brought your Bibles today. Mom. I have my Bible. I hope you have your Bibles at home right now. Loving what I read in this book, you know, it feeds life into me. It gives me wisdom. The Word of God. It gives me peace and empowerment. Do you know that the sword of the Spirit? Thanks for bringing your Bibles, guys, by the way. Good job. Awesome, guys. Very good, Scotty. That very sword is what you're going to use throughout your life as your offensive weapon, right? The armor of God gives us the helmet of salvation, the chestplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the shoes of peace, right? The shield of faith, and the sword of the Spirit. Which one of these is an offensive weapon? It's the sword, right? So most of the time, the enemy throws things at us we're not aware of. And actually, don't even know he's doing it half the time. He's bombarding and hitting us with things. But our armor is covering all of our parts, so that no matter what angle he comes at, it deflects off that armor. And what do we want to do then? And Pastor Randy talks about spanking the devil. And that means chasing him away. Getting him away from you, telling him, go to a dry, arid place and leave me alone. Go far, far away from me because I'm a son and a daughter of God and you have no rights to me. In fact, I'm in God's family. I'm grafted into his family. And so you're going to use your sword of the Spirit. Greater is he who's in me than he who is in the world. Get your hands off of me. I belong to Jesus. And you start speaking faith like that, you are wielding a sword, an offensive weapon, to get the enemy back and away from you. Ranger Derby will be August 15th, and we are going to resume the Ranger classes here at the church in the month of June. It will be announced. And we want to make sure we didn't forget what we learned, and we're going to review it with Isaiah before he goes off to college. I talked to him today. And he's such a great young man to work with. He's so positive, and he's just a ray of sunshine. So after that, then, Miss Lori will continue training you, and we'll see what we can do with our other teachers to help her, and so that they all support each other and make this thing come out fantastic for Jesus, guys. Thank you. You guys at home, make sure that you're doing your chores, earning some money, putting it aside for church. Again, it doesn't fund this kid's church, but it does fund missionaries overseas, and that's where we're reaching our local community, our broad community, and to the ends of the earth through our missionaries that were called by God to do so. Thank you so much. Come on up. Thank you, Scotty. Thank you, Sarah. And Miss Lori. Slam dunking for Jesus right there. And a hug. Love you. All right. Miss Faithy's in the back, and she's still struggling to get out something out of her little purse there. Come on, Faithy! There you go. Good job. Awesome. You see on the slide here, there's all different races of people represented, but they're really part of one race. That's the human race. And when you hear that phrase, you might ask some questions. For starters, what exactly does soul mean? What does every soul mean, right? And what does it mean for something to matter? Well, before I tell you, let's find out what you think those words mean. If you think you know that soul means raise, what it means, raise your hand. And in this case, if you're on Zoom with us in the chat, say yes if you know what soul means, okay? If you think you know what it means for something to matter, say yes in the chat. Do you know what it means for something to matter? Well, I think most of you guys do. And basically, a soul is a person, right? The soul of a person. It's the parts of your life that goes with you after you die. And for something to matter just means that something is important. So to say every soul matters to God means that every person is equally important to God. God gave us 10 simple commands to follow. Commandments 5 through 10 tell us how to treat others. Can we take a look at the 10 commandments slide? Let's take a look. So, if you notice on the 10 commandments, God gave the first four, and those four were relating to God himself. Do not worship other gods. Do not make any idols. Do not misuse the name of God. And keep the Sabbath holy. Those are four ways that we relate to God, according to God, right? He gave the 10 commandments. Now, the next ones are this, related to man. Honor your father and mother. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not lie. And do not covet. So he wants us to treat others properly. And that's why he gave us commandments 5 through 10. Now I want you to check out this video with our friend, Damaris. Damaris is going to tell us more about our lesson today. Check it out.
Hey everyone, my name is Damaris, and I'm here to introduce our brand new series, Every Soul Matters to God. Did you hear that? Every soul. That's a whole bunch of people. In fact, did you know there are approximately 7.7 billion people in this world? That's a lot. Want to know something else that's crazy? According to scientists, there are 1 billion trillion stars in the universe that we know of. And the Bible says in Isaiah 40:26, God calls each star by its name. Can you imagine keeping up with that many names? Sometimes my grandma gets me and my sister's names mixed up.
Hey, Patsy Jane!
Grandma, it's Damaris. Those don't even sound similar. I can't imagine keeping up with 1 billion trillion names. And neither can my grandma.
Hey there, Donna!
But God knows every star by name. And guess what? Isaiah chapter 40 also says, the same God that knows the stars by name takes care of his people. That's you and me. If God knows the stars, how much more does he know and love people? Way more. That means he knows every person's name too. All 7.7 billion of us, even you. Today we're learning how every soul matters to God. Not just good souls, Christians, nice people, rich people, or people who are just like you and me. Nope. Every single person, ever. Now it's time for you to get into your lesson all about how every soul matters to God. Until next time, this is Damaris. See ya!
Wow, there's a lot of people in this world, and God loves every single one of them. You're going to learn about how every soul matters to God. But right now, I want you to listen to our friend, Boudreaux, who's going to teach you what you got to know. Listen.
What you got to know, what you got to know. Time for Boudreaux, what you got to know. What you got to know.
Boudreaux, that's pronounced Boudreaux. And I'm here to tell you what you gotta know. I'm so excited to be starting a brand new series called called Every Soul Matters to God. Today, we're talking all about how God don't just love a few people, He loves everybody. So every time today you hear somebody ask you what you got to know, you tell them red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves little children of the world. Man, oh man, I should have known that song. That is a good reminder that God loves everybody, every single person. Sometimes we feel that only certain people are important to God, or only special people are. That ain't right. Every soul matters to God. So every time today you hear somebody ask you what you got to know, you tell them red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. And they're right there, what you got to know. Well, I'm Boudreaux from Bayou Saint. Bye-bye.
Here's what you got to know for today. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. And that's just a sweet song and a sweet way to remember it. You know, none of us are truly black, white, yellow, or red, right? We have different tinges and tones to our skin. And if I was white, I'd probably be the color of this piece of paper. So as you can see, I've got a lot of olive going on in my skin, right? So we're all a blend. In fact, a lot of the people in the Middle East, the Jews, people that were from Israel back when Jesus was alive and that are from Israel now, they have an olive tone to their skin. They're kind of a mixture of all of everyone's color all put together, right? So let's remember, when we see people with different skin on, God loves us all the same. All right, so now that we got through that, I was just so excited about worship. I was talking about it earlier before. But now it is time for worship. So I'm going to call my worship team forward. And happy birthday, Eenie. I think I saw in the chat it was Eenie's birthday. And she just celebrated it. And so I am super glad that you celebrated your birthday. I hope that you got some things you were wanting for your birthday and that you know how much you're loved by your church family and your direct family, excuse me, at home as well. I am healthy. I choked them out and spit. Sorry there. Praise the Lord, though. We're staying very healthy as a family. Right, guys? Very, very healthy. And that's all from Jesus. That's from the Lord right there. Good job, good job. That was awesome. Oh, excuse me. That was a long run I was just on. What's going on? Running is the bomb. Am I right?
Yes, it's good for you, but who are you?
My bad. I'm Ron. Ron D. Race. My friends call me Ron, but my mom calls me Sugar Pie. You can call me either one. I answer to both.
I'll go with Ron. What are you doing here, Ron? Nice to meet you.
Well, I was cutting through your building on my way to the park for my big race coming up, and I'm getting ready for it. But I was wondering what's going on in here. Some kind of kid genius meeting to take over the school system or something?
No, this is Kids Church, Mom. Today we are learning that every soul matters to God.
Whoa, for real? Every soul? That's insane! Even the stinky worn-out ones?
Yes, every soul. God loves everyone the same. Oh, it does not matter what they smell like.
I knew God was caring, but to think He cares about my old garbage-smelling running shoes from last summer, wow, I mean, this is just This is just mind-blowing.
Wait. Why would God care about your shoes? I mean, people are what God cares about, not shoes.
But you said every soul matters. And my stinky shoes that I ran over 430 miles in each year have laces, a tongue, and a soul.
Oh, I get the problem you're experiencing now. Like, kids, you are talking about soul, S-O-L-E. That is part of a shoe.
Yes.
And I am talking about an soul, S-O-U-L, as in the human soul.
Oh, well, that definitely changes the meaning of every soul matters to God. I guess it would be okay to get rid of my old smelly running shoes now.
Yes, that would be possibly a good idea, Mom.
Well, especially with Father's Day coming up. You know, so now I know that every soul matters, meaning every person matters to God. What should I do with that information? I mean, why is it so important?
It is important. We should run all over telling everyone that we matter to God.
Oh yeah, I got this.
That's the attitude you should have, Mom.
Well, thanks, I tried. Watch. Every soul matters to God. Every soul matters to God. Every soul matters to God.
Oh, Ron the Brace.
Well, I gotta go to my running meet up in the park. I'm almost late now. But I'll spread the word about God and souls, and not shoe souls, by the way.
All right, that sounds good.
You
have a good run.
Thanks, I will. Later, Gator.
Cool. Oh, I know this one. After a while, Crocodile.
Night. See ya.
Ron, I'm really learning something today. Soul is S-O-U-L. That's where the person has in their heart. The soul is there. It's the God. He knows our soul. He knows our hearts.
He knows everything.
And he has the right picture. We have to tell everyone, boys and girls, everyone, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Some great things are happening in LifeKids, and I want to show you right now. We have prize points. These are points we give out every week. Just for coming, you get one. And you get one also for bringing your Bibles, memory verses. Sometimes we'll go over memory verses, and if you memorize them, you'll get prize coins. And guess what we have? We have a prize cabinet for all you boys and girls, and we have some. It is stocked right now. It is stocked.
Wow. If you know my story, my code word is fun. So we're all about having fun here at LifeKids. So I'm so excited for you all tuning in, and I look forward to seeing you in person next week. And if your parents decide to wait, that's fine too. We'll be here. We'll still be having it on the air for all to see. We love you. And that's what God is all about. He's love. So we're all about showing the love of Christ here. And we're very blessed to be able to do this every week. And I think someone's coming to the stage to talk to you about our Bible study.
Yes.
Pastor Scott.
All right. Yes. Oh, yes. I'll be right with you.
So we are so excited, and we are just blessed beyond anything to be here to serve.
Woo, every soul does matter. You know, Ron sure did have a good lesson for us today that we don't want to forget. It's not about shoe souls. It's about winning souls, people, to Jesus. Why? Because that's his just reward. His just reward is the souls that are saved by his dying for us. Well, let's play a little game today. Let's go to the next slide, Sarah. And let's take a look at this. All right, for this, I need Miss Lori on the chat. Miss Lori in the chat, and we are going to go over some questions that I think a lot of you are going to know, but not everybody. So we want to see who knows the most amount of these questions, okay? And they're from history. They're from history. You're going to recognize a lot of these characters. Let's see how many you can get right. I discovered electricity with a kite in a lightning storm. You can whisper it to mom if you guys are, just my kids are here today. You can tell mom personally. Next week, though, some of you will be back, right? So you'll be able to participate already raising your hands. Today, we're going to just do the chat. So who is it that discovered electricity with a kite in a lightning storm? Boy, I hope he wasn't holding the end of the kite string when it struck, because that would have really, really hurt.
All right, we have two. Let's see. Sarah has an answer. Let's see what Sarah's is.
I think it's Benjamin Franklin.
Okay, and then we have one on the chat that says Ben Franklin, too. So we have two for Ben Franklin.
Two for Ben Franklin. All right, let's see the answer. It's
Benjamin
Franklin.
Franklin.
Yeah. Very good, guys. You both got that right. Let's see our next question. I was the first man ever created. Do you remember me?
God.
Who? Well, God was the first man ever created. Scotty's God is
Adam,
God. He's
Adam,
always been.
Adam, Eve, and Eve.
Okay, one at a time.
And then
they're
Eve.
Saying it. Okay, Adam is the
Scotty and Sarah were super excited to give that answer because they knew it. And I think you guys might agree. Let's see if the answer is there, Sarah. Show us. It's Adam.
Yes.
It is Adam.
Woo.
Yes, very good. Very
Smart.
Good. All right, next. I was raised from the dead by Jesus after 3 days. Raised from the
All
dead.
All right, Sarah.
What's his name? Lazarus.
Lazarus.
And Scotty, what's your answer? Is it the same? Okay, they're saying Lazarus.
Lazarus.
Yes!
Lazarus.
Good job.
You know, interesting how he was dead for about 3 days. And who else do we know that was dead for 3 days in the Bible? And came back to life. Somebody else we know real well. His name's Jesus, right? So Jesus, that was kind of a foreshadowing of what was to come with our Lord and Savior right there. Next question. I was the first man elected president of the United States. Who's our first president?
We have George Washington.
George Washington.
Yes.
All right, let's check out the answer. It's George Washington.
Woo, good
Very
job.
Good. Very good. Next one. Miss Sarah. I was Jesus' mother. Do you remember me?
Mary.
Okay.
Mary.
All right. I heard Mary before we
yes,
said anything.
They got
Mary.
It right.
That is correct. Number six. I was the strongest man in the Bible. Do you remember me? Okay, guys, in the chat box right now. Who was the strongest man? In the Bible. We have an answer?
Yes,
yeah.
Samson,
someone
yes.
said. He had that long hair that couldn't be cut, right?
Yeah.
The answer, Samson. Samson is correct. Very good, very good. Number seven. I lived in the belly of a whale for 3 days. Are you noticing a theme here that's going on in these questions, guys? Do you notice a common theme? And that would be the three-day theme. Interesting. And let's see the answer. It's Jonah. Jonah
Good
for 3 days.
Again.
Lazarus for 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus for 3 days. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are
three in one.
Huh.
Interesting. There is a total
when Jesus
three.
Was crucified, there were three men grouped together. It was Jesus with a man on his right and left. I'd say three is a holy number, guys. Three is a very holy number. Samson.
Okay.
Who was it?
Okay,
who was
Scotty,
it? You guys
go
know? Go ahead. What's the answer we're getting, Miss Laura? And it's Delilah.
Delilah.
So, see the answer, just to confirm, but we know. It's
Goliath.
Number 10.
And they're saying on the chat, Jesus.
Jesus, very good.
Jesus.
Show the answer again there, Sarah. It's Jesus. Very good.
Praise
good,
the
guys.
Lord.
Excellent
Thank
job.
You.
Excellent
did
job.
A great job.
And let's check this out. I want you to turn in your Bibles, guys, to Acts chapter 10. And we're going to cover verses 1 through 33. So this is a pretty big section that we're covering here in the book of Acts, of chapter 10. Have it open and take a look at it as I'm reading along, okay, and as I'm teaching this. Today's Bible story is found in Acts chapter 10. One day, God appeared to the apostle Peter in a dream as he was sleeping. God showed Peter a vision of a blanket coming down from heaven that had a bunch of animals on it. God told Peter to kill the animals and eat them. This food was the kind of food that Peter had been taught never to eat. Peter was so offended, he couldn't believe God was asking him to kill and eat that kind of food. He told God, "I have never eaten any food that is impure." God told Peter, "Do not call anything impure that I have made clean." This happened 3 times, and then Peter woke up. Through these dreams, Peter realized that God was trying to teach him an important lesson. You see, Peter had a big problem. He and the other disciples had bad feelings about anyone who was not a Jew from birth. They told the Jews about Jesus, no problem, but they refused to share the good news of Jesus with the Gentiles. Peter was one of the main disciples who dealt with this prejudice, or choosing not to love others because they were different. Right after Peter woke up from his dream, there was a knock at his door. Men at the door were servants of a man named Cornelius. One of them said, "My master Cornelius would like to see you." So they took Peter to Cornelius' house. Cornelius was not a Jew, but God told him to bring Peter to his house so Peter could tell everyone about Jesus. Peter realized that God was trying to teach him through those dreams that God loved everybody the same. He looked, there they are. There he's sharing it with them. God loves everyone the same. He told Cornelius' family, "I now realize that God does not show favoritism, but accepts men from every nation." He basically said, "I've come to realize that every soul matters to God." It was a powerful moment. Peter prayed with Cornelius' entire family to accept Jesus that day. It was a miracle. It happened because Peter chose to treat others just as God does. He showed love to Cornelius, a Roman, right? Someone who was of the Romans, the people that were oppressing his very family, his very people, but he showed them love anyway. And his family, even though they were different, it didn't matter. It didn't matter to Peter. Peter had been shown this vision of this blanket coming down from heaven and that nothing was unclean. That is what each of us must do as well. We must treat others the way God wants us to treat them. And we treat them with respect and love because they are a creation of God. Today in your lesson, you're going to learn about the importance of loving others and treating them like they matter to you. If every soul matters to God, every soul should matter to us. Well, I agree with that 100%. Every soul matters to me. And I hope you guys all feel the same way. You know, God has given us such love, his love, and put it right into our hearts. He's taught us how to love others through his actions in the Bible, and he teaches us daily as we walk with him. As we seek his will and we pray to him for help with things that we're struggling with, we see how we work through them. We see how he shows up. We see how things always end up working out eventually. One way or another, God just works them out. God's in control, and he is love. So let's be love like God is love. Let's let that love come out of us and pour out into other people. Let the light of Christ shine out through you. God wants to work through you. That was his pleasure in creating you in the first place. Okay, guys? So remember that. Love everybody. Today's power verse is coming from our old but beloved friend, Kent Heria. He can see you, but he can't hear you. So here he comes. Let's check out what he has to say to us today.
Hoo! Hoo! I'm 72 years old, so I'm a little bit hard of hearing. But the reason why I'm here is I'm here to teach you today's power verse. And today's power verse says, the Lord does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. 2 Peter 3:9. Wow, that was a wonderful verse, wasn't it? Now, I tell you what I'm going to need you to do. I'm going to need you to say it with me and say it loud. After all, I am a little hard of hearing. If you can say it so loud that my loud old meter gets all the way up to 10, then we're going to get to do something really fun to my nephew. Gary says he wants me to put a cat on his head. Okay, so here we go. On the count of three, make it loud. 1, 2, 3. The Lord.
The Lord does not want everyone to be destroyed, but
he wants everyone to repent.
2 Peter 3:9.
Oh, that was pretty good, pretty good. But I still can't hear you. Get it? All right, we'll try it one more time, but this time I want it to be loud. Let's get this thing all the way up to 10, all right? Here we go. 1, 2, 3.
Kitty cats so much, especially not that mean kitty. But anyway, let's go over this. The Lord does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. 2 Peter 3:9. The first part of that verse says the Lord does not want anyone to be destroyed. Well, anytime there's a statement in the Bible, let's always ask why. Why? Why does it say that? And let's think it through. Well, it's because they will not be in heaven with God if they're destroyed, right? And God loves all of his creation. And so he didn't create it just for it to live 70 to 100 years. He created a person to live for eternity. And he wants that person with him. He doesn't want them to be destroyed. And what destroys people? Well, sin does. Sin destroys people. The wages of sin is death. And so we don't want to be involved with sinning. Number two, the second part. He wants everyone to repent. What does that mean, repent? A lot of people don't know what that word means. Well, to repent is to admit that we did something that was wrong. We tell God that we reject that sin and we plan not to ever do it again. And if we do, guess what? We have to realize we messed up a second time and come back to God and say, I thought I wasn't going to do that again, but I did. Lord, please help me, strengthen me, and guide me so I don't do it ever, ever again. I repent of it, I turn away from it, and I leave it behind me. I look and turn my face to you, Almighty Father. I turn to you, shine your light on me, and help me overcome that sin or that weakness I have in Jesus' name. Amen. That's confessing and repenting of the sin that's been plaguing you, right? Maybe the enemy's sending it at you. Maybe it's just your own flesh doing it, but it doesn't matter where it's coming from. Jesus will help you overcome that. I guarantee it. All right? Well, let's go on to our next slide here and take a look at this. It's called Every Soul, right? Every soul. Every soul matters to God. You matter to God. I matter to God. The neighbor down the street matters to God. And someone over in China that we don't know that's at home right now, maybe they're a Christian in their house and having a Bible study in secret. And they can't let no one know around it because it's dangerous. Some places could be a Christian. Thank God right now with me. Lord, thank you that I live in the United States where I am safe to be a Christian. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so, so much. Please turn the light back on in the back there. And today we're going to start things off with a little activity. I'm going to pull an item out of this box behind me and show it to you. I want you to tell me whether or not it's something you like. So let's see here. I got some little fun things I put together during the weekend here. I run around in this church all the time. I work at home, I work here, and I have fun doing this stuff. So let's see here. Let's pull out the first item here and see what we have. What do we have here? What's her name? We'll call her Jenny. Hi, Jenny, how are you?
I'm doing pretty good.
Well, that's good, Jenny. Now, how many of you guys like puppets? Go ahead and say it in the chat if you like puppets.
Yes.
You look kind of sweaty there. Let me wipe off your brow. Oh, thank you so much, Jenny. That is so nice of you. She's so nice. She's a nice puppet, isn't she? I like nice puppets. So that's one thing that some of you might like. Another thing you might like is candy. Sometimes we in the prize cabinet have candy in there, Smarties and things like that. And I bet a lot of you like candy. I would be betting safe on that, I think. How about prize coins? I think most of us like prize coins. And we have updated our prize cabinet with more prizes. And we're always on the lookout for more cool stuff. So, hey, you know, if any of you ever find somewhere that has really cool stuff for the prize cabinet, you can even let me know, okay? Let Miss Lori know. And we want to keep it fun for you guys. We'd like to reward you for good behavior and for bringing your Bibles and for participating in winning contests when we have contests in here. Okay? Another thing, how about birthday parties? How about birthday parties? Do we like to have parties celebrating New Year, having birthdays and celebrating that kind of stuff? I would say most of you are going to say you like that, right? Okay? How about the Bible? Do we like the Bible? I hope so. I like the Bible. And this one here is a little beginner's Bible. And my kids have this Bible. This might be one of my kids' Bibles that they left here. But anyway, I found this sitting around in kids' church. And it's a beginner's Bible. But no matter whether it's a beginner's Bible or a full-fledged adult Bible, I love the Bible. Okay? I love the Word of God. And I mean, how many of you like video games? I got Mario Kart here. It's a little retro, but hey, it's fun. You gotta admit, Mario Kart is the bomb, so we like that. We definitely like that. But, that was a 90s term I just used, by the way. 1990s, that is. How many like seafood?
No.
Sarah says no. Now, I see I'm starting to lose some of you here. I think some of you maybe don't like seafood. You like eating crab legs?
Yeah.
Yeah, you like perch, walleye, you like lobster?
Yeah. I hate it. It's gross.
I like shellfish myself. I'm not so much into normal fish. There are certain types of fish, but what do we have? Tilapia at home, right?
Good.
I like tilapia. It kind of like, sort of almost tastes like chicken, so I like it. And, but I do like shellfish. I don't like to be selfish, though, so let's not be selfish, but I do like to eat shellfish, okay? Here's another thing. How about this, guys? Do you like chore lists?
No!
No, my kids are saying no, they don't like chore lists.
We hate it!
Come on, don't you like to clean your room? Don't you like to wash the dishes?
No!
Don't you like to take out the garbage?
No, I am going to.
You do a little bit with me, don't you? Just a little bit? Maybe.
Why do you like to take out the garbage?
Because we're doing it together and it's fun to do things together.
No, wait.
Mm-hmm. How about cleaning the bathroom? Anyone like to scrub the bathroom floor or the toilet?
No, no, no.
How about vacuum all the carpets in the house?
No. In every single room?
No!
Okay, well, they're screaming no, guys. They don't like all that stuff. And how many of you guys like rubber chickens with prize coins in their mouth?
Me! I like rubber chickens.
We love the rubber chicken. He's our little mascot in the back. But anyway, I noticed that there were a lot of things that you guys really liked in this box. And there were other things that seemed like you didn't like them at all. You know, life is like that. We have a freedom of choice, right? We can like some things and not like other things. Sadly, many people think the same choice applies to accepting other people. They think that they can love and accept some people, but then choose to dislike and mistreat other people. Sadly, some people make the choice to dislike whole groups of people simply because of the color of their skin, the way they dress, what country they came from. It's called prejudice. And isn't that sad? It's not only sad, it's the opposite of how God wants us to be. Even the Apostle Peter struggled with this. Even though Jesus told the disciples it was their job to go and make disciples of all the nations, that was their instruction, and it was very clear. You'd think the disciples would have understood and meant that they were going to spread the gospel everywhere, right? To everyone. Well, through this dream Peter had, he realized that God was teaching him some lessons that we need to learn as well. Let's learn from Peter's lessons, okay? Because I think we can glean a lot of good information out of it. The next slide says, God loves everyone the same. God loves everyone the same. Check out this Bible verse, guys. This should get a hold of your heart, okay? John 3:16. For God so loved the world. It didn't say that he only loves certain people, does it? God sees everyone the same. He doesn't love one group more than another. He loves Americans just as much as he loves Africans, Asians, Latinos, and all other people groups. He loves tall people as much as he loves short people. Everyone is equal in God's eyes. It's like it says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world. He still loves the world. We don't always act like that is the case, though, do we? Sometimes we act like we think we are better than others, or we treat people who are in a different situation than us, that they're not as good as us. We think we can't be friends with those people. It's like we put a label on them or say, loser, you know, no good. That's not what God wants us to do. He doesn't want us to ever do that. In fact, I must never label others. I must never label others. Show that slide, Sarah. I must never label others. We do that sometimes as well. We label others and then put them in groups. We think that some people are more important than others. I bet we can think of five random people. We look at others and we put labels on them, deciding what they're worth. So one kid might be really smart, and maybe he's a computer programming, coding guy, and they give him a label of, well, he's a nerd, you know, he's a computer nerd. They're not good for anything but reading books and computer programming and taking tests. Is that right, though, to label someone like that just because they're good at something? I don't think so. How about another one? How about an athlete? We decide, well, that person is strong as an athlete, but they're not smart. He's got to be dumb because he's so good at football. It must have been all his talent went into that. He can't possibly be smart, can he? Bad assumption to make, guys. How about the word poor? We decide that a person doesn't have much money and they don't dress very nicely. I can't be their friend, or I won't be as popular. And so we just label them as a poor person, right? Gee, you know, we have so much blessing in this country. Maybe, just maybe, we have something that might fit them that's new, that because we have too many clothes to begin with. and we could maybe give them a gift, right? How about a Christmas or sometime when you get so many things to wear that you don't know when you're going to even get to them, right? Well, how about giving one of those pairs of pants and shirt to someone who's less fortunate that you know? And then they won't have to wear those old clothes, will they? Because you blessed them from the abundance God gave you. Out of that, you gave to them. God will bless you for that, guys. How about another person? We're going to label this person a liar. This person told a lie once, so they're not to be trusted ever. I hope nobody is ever their friend, because they're a liar. Well, if that were the case, I think no one would have any friends in the entire world. I find it hard to believe there's one person that exists in the entire universe other than Jesus Christ himself that's never lied or stretched the truth, as some might call it, conveniently to protect themselves, right? So let's not put that label on someone. How about the word popular? Put the word popular on a person. That person is the most popular kid in school. So they must be cool and amazing. I wish I could be her friend or his friend because they're so popular. I mean, if I was their friend, I would probably have the best friend in the whole wide world. Not true, guys. We put these labels on others. We decide how much they're worth. And based on the labels that we've given them or others give them, the problem is that when we label others, many times it keeps us from showing them God's love. That's what's happening with Peter. So what should we do? I must love others just as God loves them. Let's show that slide. We need to learn the same lesson Peter learned. We should never label others as not worthy, not good as us. We have to get rid of these labels and begin to look at others through God's eyes. God sees everyone as important. He sees everyone as worthy of his love. He sees everyone as worthy of sending his son for them. And boy, if he sees them that way, can't I? You know, maybe I need to get on my knees and I need to say a prayer right now, if that's me, right? Maybe I need to say, "Dear Lord Jesus, I have judged people, I have put labels on them in the past, but from this day forward, I'm going to walk with you, and I want you to show me what you love about each and every one of them. Give me your heart for them, and let me see the beautiful, special talents and special aspects of them and their life and the things they do. Let me see the light of you shining out through them and not put a label on them. In fact, if I recognize that they do something good, Lord, give me the courage to say, you know what? You do that really well. Just one word of encouragement can change a person's life, guys. You know, many people became artists and architects and engineers and doctors. One person spoke into their life and gave them some kind of hope, and that changed their entire life and turned it around. And today, they became a doctor, an architect, an airplane pilot, a builder, you know, a real estate tycoon, whatever it may be, or even a pastor, right? Someone spoke into their life, and there was a moment where something shifted and changed. That's what I want you to do. Be the light, kids. Be the light. That's what we are supposed to be doing. Be the light for this world, this dark and confused and angry world, this world that has riots and has illness in it. We are the light. Be it. Don't be part of the problem. Be part of the solution. Give them Jesus. Give them Jesus. Jesus healed everyone's heart. I don't care what's going on in there. He heals it. All right, let's do rewind. Rewind! And check out these questions, guys. We're going to keep this going at a good clip. So, Miss Lori, I need you to be ready to fire away on that microphone as you get an answer in, okay? Once you get the correct answer from someone, I want you to read it to me. And here we go. What you got to know today? Was it red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in the sight? Or was it every soul matters? Or was it I matter? Okay, Miss Lori, read the first one that pops up there.
All right. See if it takes fast.
All right. My kid, any answers for this one?
One, two, or three?
What you got to know?
The first one, the second one, or the third one there on the screen. Which one do you think it is, kids?
All right, we have number one. Which one's Sarah? Sarah says it's possibly...
You think it's number, maybe number, which one? Two? Every soul matters?
Yeah, sure.
All right, let's see.
Say which one?
Reveal the answer, Sarah. Sarah, are you revealing the answer?
Yes, I'm trying, okay?
Oh, it's red, yellow, black, and white. Woo! They are precious in his sight.
Yes.
That's what you got to know. That's what you got to know. Remember that. God doesn't see color. He sees the heart. Next. In our Bible story, what did God show Peter in his dream? Number one, new shoes he was supposed to buy. This is Peter we're talking about now. Two, well, there's the answer. Food he wasn't supposed to eat. So the answer to number two is food that he wasn't supposed to eat. That's what God showed him, and he told him in the dream, don't call these items unclean that I've made clean. And once God makes something clean, guess what? It's cleaner than the laundromat to get it. It's cleaner than your washer and dryer to get it. It's perfectly clean. Number three.
We have some technical difficulties.
Number three. Even if we are having a technical difficulty, I can't stop now. What lesson was God's teaching Peter through his dreams? One, every soul matters to God. Two, food is bad. Or three, we can only eat chicken nuggets. That's hilarious, by the way. I don't think it was that. Is it one, two, or three? Answers.
All right. People in the chat, answers.
One, two, or three? What lesson was God teaching Peter through his dreams? Every soul matters to God, food is bad, or we can only eat chicken nuggets? And the answer, Sarah? Every soul matters to God.
Matters.
Every soul, very good guys, every soul matters to God. Number four, Sarah, let's look to us number four. What was the name of the man who Peter went to visit? One, Nathaniel. Two, Sebastian. Or three, was it Cornelius?
And the answer is number three, we're getting from the chat. Is it number three?
Yes, Cornelius. Yes, Cornelius.
Ooh,
that's number three.
Cornelius.
Very good. Very good, guys. Let's see what number five is. What's question number five? True or false? Peter struggled with prejudice.
True or false?
Did he have prejudice at one time going on in his head, rolling around up there?
They are saying number one.
Number one. Okay, let's see, Sarah. The answer is true.
Woohoo!
Yes, he had a little prejudice going around. He thought, well, they got to be a Jew or they got to be an Israelite or else, you know, I can't share all this with them. But God said, no, not the case, Peter. You got to go tell everybody about this.
Great
one. Number six. True or false? Only some souls matter to God. True or false? One or two? One true, two false. Only some souls matter to God.
All right, number two. The kids are saying.
They're saying
false.
Only some souls, false. Yes, let's see the answer. Number two, false. Yes.
Woo!
Correct. All souls matter to God, right? Number seven question now. Let's look at that. The next question, Sarah. According to our lesson today, God loves everyone blank blank. Okay, so God loves everyone one, a little. He loves everyone two, kind of, sort of. Or three, God loves everyone the same. So what are we seeing there for our answers? One, two, or three?
Number three, Pastor Scott.
Sarah, the answer? The same. Number three. He
yes.
loves everyone the same. God loves everybody the same.
No favorites.
We got to remember that.
He loves everyone.
I mean, I hammered that home today with this lesson because I want us to remember it. It's really, really important.
Yes.
You know, you don't know who the next Martin Luther King will be or the next president of the United States is going to be when you meet him. Sometimes you just think you're meeting another person, but later on you find out, well, I remember that kid. Now that kid's president, you know? So let's treat everybody the same. According to our lesson today, I must never label others, tickle others, or trust others. So I must never, one, label, two, tickle, or three, trust.
We are having answers from one answer here is number one.
Uno. Uno. Let's see, is it Uno? Show us.
Yes.
Label.
Label. We must never label others. Very good. Number nine, Sarah. According to our lesson today, I must blank others just as God blank them. So I must, one, see others just as God sees them. Two, I must love others just as God loves them. Or three, I must hug others just as God hugs them. And what do you think it is?
And we're showing number one.
I must see others just as God sees them. Let's see what the answer is. Sarah, there we go. I must love others just as God loves them.
Love.
And I know, I see, and I know what they meant when they were saying, I must see others just as God sees them.
Right, that's the right one too.
I can bend the rules a little bit on that answer because it's like, you know, how he sees them, we want to see them.
Yeah,
that was even the prayer I prayed. Because I want to make sure that God gets in there, you know, gets in here. Because without him in here, there isn't nothing good coming out probably, right? We want him getting in so that good things are pouring out. And let's see the next last question, Sarah. Let's see if you guys can get it. Where was our power verse found? 2 Timothy 14:10, Proverbs 3:9, or 2 Peter 3:9? Ooh, which one is it? I think I remember what it is. The first one,
number
the second
three.
One, the third one.
They're
number
all saying number three.
Let's see. 2 Peter 3:9, they are correct. You guys are right. You got it.
Yay!
Excellent job. I'm proud of you guys for paying attention. You guys are great to have in here with me, whether you're in here physically or you're in here online. And if you guys would please pay attention now, Sarah and Scotty and Faithy, I want you guys to pray this prayer with me, okay?
Let's all pray together.
And let's play some soft music, Sarah. All right. There we go. To Matthew West, and this is a great song that's come out that we think is fantastic. Well, many songs that he's come out with. Let's go ahead and play that song, The God Who Stays, right? It's been out for a little while, and we love it. We love it. So, all right, Lord, in a world suffering with sickness, in a world where people mistreat other people, in a world where there is protests and some things that have been destroyed, make us the light in this world, Lord. Shine your light out through us. We pray for peace. Help us to remember that we must love others just as God loves them. We know that you love us all the same, Lord. You don't look at our skin color. You don't care where we come from. You just love us right now as we are. Lord, we choose to make you our Lord and Savior, Jesus, today and every day of our life. Amen. Amen. Thanks for joining us today, kids. And I really am so happy to share this message. It's such a timely message for the world we're living in today. Take this all into your heart. Remember to love others as the Lord loves others. That's completely. And remember, I love you as your pastor, and Jesus loves you. And I will see you guys soon. Remember, next Sunday, that's the 14th of June, we'll be right here with volunteers, hand sanitizer, and chair spread so that we're safe. But we're going to meet in faith, and we're going to worship the Lord and learn together in person again. And I can't wait to see your smiling faces. I miss you so much. And it's going to be great to see you. God bless you.
Wait,
see you next week.
Not wait.